Hello. First of all, thanks to MIQT Rotations, Dr. Bernard, Dr. Stein, and Dr. Naka for giving this opportunity. My topic today will be recent developments in the treatment of Parkinson's disease. Now, I want to make a comment that the things that I will discuss today, majority of them are either in clinical trials or part of them are in preclinical trials awaiting approval to be involved to for the clinical trials to start. So this is like a very emerging treatment. It's not the classical one. So Parkinson's disease is a common neurodegenerative disease characterized by a movement disorder consisting of bradykinesia, of tremor, of resting tremor, rigidity, along with postural instability. And the hallmark of this disease is that specific group of neurons, as all of us know, in substantia nigra, die out, and therefore striatum does not have any dopamine to get stimulated with. The mainstay of classic treatment of the established treatment is to replenish these dopamine supplies. But the new emerging treatments that are currently in the trials or they are in the preclinical investigational period, they are targeting the other etiological factors and other pathologic circles in the development of PD, such as alpha-synuclein misfolding and aggregation, impaired protein clearance, mitochondrial dysfunction, and neuroinflammation. But why is there a need for new therapies when we have current dopamine replenishing treatments? Well, the thing is that even though whilst often effective at improving motor function, current treatments are associated with the significant side effects due to delivery of dopamine to extrastriatal regions, to a variability in their absorption and transit across the blood-brain barrier, and also due to non-physiologic continuous release of dopamine that eventually affects dopamine receptors within the basal ganglia. In addition to these, patients who are treated with the treatments available nowadays usually develop cognitive problems in 46%, levodopa-induced dyskinesias is 56%, and over time, on-off fluctuations in almost all of these patients. And otherwise, even though motor problems are the main feature of the disease, autonomic instability and cognitive impairment, which develops throughout the disease, is not affected by the already existing medications. These drugs do not change the developmental pace of the disease. They do not stop the neurodegeneration, which also spreads to autonomic ganglia, and that's why these patients develop autonomic instability as well. From the dopamine replenishing treatments, the first choice is always MAO-B inhibitors in minimal symptom disease when the disease has just started on the patient is very young. There are also dopamine agonist therapies, but their neuropsychiatric effects such as impulse control disorder is very hard for patients to manage. And that also produces some difficulties as well as we have also DBS and FAST treatments, which will be discussed a bit later. I will start the novel medications with a recently approved drug called cefinamide, which was approved in March of 2017 by FDA. It is an MAO-B inhibitor, but it also has non-dopaminergic neurotransmitter system effects. It blocks sodium channels on the neuronal plates, and it also inhibits glutamate release. And by this way, it works on multiple levels and is proposed to have better effects than only other MAO-B inhibitors. Nowadays, it's more commonly used in conjunction with levodopa or levodopa-carbidopa, and it's termed to be very effective. Acetylcholinesterase inhibitors such as rivastigmine and donepezil are also said to be effective in patients with PD, and particularly they decrease the risk of falls in these patients. Norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, methylphenidate and atomoxetine are proposed to to decrease incidence of postural instability and to improve gait. While serotonergic agents decrease dyskinesias that frequently are a byproduct of dopamine replenishing therapies. Particularly interesting medication, to say like a medication in this list, is the nurturing, which belongs to glial cell line derived neurotrophic factors. And the thing is that this particular medication has been researched mainly in PD models in animals. It hasn't been yet tried in humans, but it has very promising effects. And it actually has the potential to affect the development, the pathological process that develops in PD patients to stop or to slow down the progression of the disease. Putative disease modifying therapies for PD are summarized on this slide. There are some RNA interference and also oligonucleotides and beta, and some repurposing of already known medications such as beta agonists, as well as some medications that are targeting mitochondria. We will discuss some of them in more detail in order of importance. So from immunotherapies, there are three major pathways that are being explored. It's passive and active immunization techniques against alpha-synuclein and antisense oligonucleotides and RNA interference techniques. Now, the last two of these three are not studied in clinical trials yet. While for passive and active immunization techniques, there are already ongoing phase one and phase two clinical trials. Now, why there is so much interest in alpha-synuclein? The thing is that alpha-synuclein aggregates are formed in the patients with PD, and it's said to be one of the pathophysiological hallmarks of the disease. And it's very interesting that these aggregates of extracellular alpha-synuclein can infect neighboring cells. So the logic is that if we somehow neutralize extracellular alpha-synuclein, the neighboring cells will stay relatively healthy, they will not get affected, and therefore disease progression will stop. For this reason, there are several humanized monoclonal antibodies currently under the phase one or phase two trials. And on this slide, you can observe the name of the trials that they can be looked up by. First is prasinezumab, which reduced free serum alpha-synuclein by approximately 97%. And phase one clinical trials are finished for these monoclonal antibodies, and phase two clinical trials are about to begin. Another very important one is Biogen, that is believed to improve the motor phenotype in a PD model under investigation currently in part two clinical trials. Also a very important one is Afiris. This is the more promising one from this list because it is about to get involved into phase three clinical trials. This company uses alpha-synuclein fragments or alpha-synuclein mimicking epitopes, which are sensitizing immune system. And there is dose-dependent immune response to peptide itself as well as to alpha-synuclein. So all of these therapies on this slide are targeting extracellular alpha-synuclein to prevent disease progression and to prevent degradation and pathologic processes in the neighboring neurons. Another more useful and logistically more easier method is drug repurposing, because a majority of these drugs have been used for years and there is enough pharmacodynamic and pharmacokinetic knowledge and database about these drugs. Kind of the part of the job is already done. We know that it's safe and they can be assessed for the Parkinson's disease. I've highlighted several of these drugs who actually had some promising results or they are currently uninvestigated. One of them is terazosin, which is an alpha-1 inhibitor as a famous drug. But the thing is that it's also can reduce alpha-synuclein levels and it can also increase ATP levels. Because of this effect, it protects neurons from apoptosis. And it's very interesting that LRRK2 mutation associated PD, which this LRRK2 mutation is causing sensitization of immune cells and inflammation activation of microglia in the CNS. So this medication has the potential to alter the pathway of the disease. And currently these trials are enrolling patients. So there are no any data yet about effectivity of terazosin. However, there is some proposition that chronic use of beta blockers has risk of increases risk of development of Parkinson's disease. I found several review articles as well as trials and research results that said that people who chronically take beta blockers, relative risk of development of Parkinson's disease is higher. So logic is that if beta blockers worsen this situation, beta agonists might actually help with reducing alpha-synuclein transcription through different modification of gene that codes for alpha-synuclein. One of the promising ones is unlikely medication, ursodeoxycholic acid, which is used for biliary cirrhosis, and it's a bile acid, and it shouldn't have anything to do with CNS and with Parkinson's disease. But it's been noted that ursodeoxycholic acid causes restoration of mitochondrial function. And one of the pathological processes happening in PD is actually mitochondrial dysfunction and damage. Randomized placebo-controlled trials are currently recruiting patients, but it has been several years, actually from 90s, that different articles have emerged in the literature that ursodeoxycholic acid might actually rescue mitochondria and cause some modulation to the Parkinson's disease. Absolutely. Only setback of this medication and the bedside of all of this research behind ursodeoxycholic acid is that the most recent trials who said that this medication is effective were actually open label, which means that the patients were aware that they were taking a medication under investigation. So this could easily be biased, and more research needs to be done about this matter. Promising one is sargramostim as well, which is GCSF analog, and it's currently in phase one, a placebo-controlled trial is completed, and now it's awaiting for the phase two approval. And nowadays, very famous company AstraZeneca has produced the medication AZD3241, which is known to reduce oxidative stress and neuroinflammation through inhibition of myeloperoxidase, and it can actually be very useful in PD patients. It has been, it has actually completed phase 2A clinical trial, and it's termed to be well tolerated, and it's reduced nigrostriatal distribution of microglia. So there is more hope for this medication today. Exenatide is another unlikely medication to be somehow helpful in PD. We know that it's been used for type 2 diabetes for many years. Is a GLP-1 receptor activator, but it also inhibits apoptosis in the CNS of the specific cells that we are interested in. Actually phase three clinical trials are about to be set up for exenatide, and this is the frontier of from this drug repurposing group of potential cures of Parkinson's disease. There is a whole bunch of medications that are addressing GBA mutations, and this GBA stands for the gene that codes for glucosyl cerebrosidase, which is involved in lipid storage diseases. But unfortunately, the trials, even though there are numerous trials about venglustat and also enzyme replacement therapy, they haven't caused any effective clinical outcomes there is no relevant clinical effectiveness proved for these medications. So most likely there is some room for development of these type of medications, but currently they aren't termed to be effective. However, ambroxol, which historically was used as an expectorant, is another one that targets its GBA glucocerebrosidase mutation-associated PD. And on the slide, you see that here are some clumps of monomeric alpha-synuclein and oligomeric alpha-synuclein, which are eventually forming Lewy bodies. This process can be caused either due to accumulation of dysfunctional mitochondria and alpha-synuclein, as well as defective glucocerebrosidase, which will not be able to degrade these clumps inside the vacuole. So if somehow we will inhibit formation of these alpha-synuclein clumps, or we will increase either transcription or activity of GBA, of the glucocerebrosidase in this particular situation with ambroxol, the autophagy will be enhanced, and therefore the entire tissue will be cleared of this extra debris, and the situation will become much better and the progression will slow down. There are also some emerging gene therapies which use very fancy technologies to deliver the medications. And target of these therapies is most frequently DOPA decarboxylase, also known as aromatic L-amino acid decarboxylase, AADC. And there is one company called Voyager made an adeno-associated virus, which takes the gene for AADC into putamen. And then this gene starts to code for DOPA decarboxylase, and more dopamine are being produced. And there is actually phase 1b data available for this medication, and it's proved to be very effective, and it's further to be involved in the following years into phase 2 trial. Another way to do this is to use lentivirus vectors, which will either use genes that code for tyrosine hydroxylase, again for AADC, and GTP cyclohydroxylase 1 gene for tetrahydrobiopterin, which is one of the cofactors in the process of neurotransmitter synthesis. Another branch of the potential therapies is cell-based therapies. And this has been an idea since 1980s, but there is not much hope for this to develop into established choice of treatment, because it has a lot of logistical problems, such as it needs to have to collect embryos and afterwards to harvest ventral mesencephalon cells, fetal ventral mesencephalon cells, and then to be injected into either putamen or into the other basal areas of the brain, which is very hard technically, as well as with other features. So there's less hope for this strategy, but there are some other trials in the Japan now ongoing, and in UK and Sweden, in where they are using pluripotent stem cells and embryonic stem cells to be injected into different areas of the brain so that they can replenish dopamine producing cells. These trials are again ongoing, and the results are about to be published, and one of these trials is actually even in the US. These are again here you see the list of all of the ongoing trials, and therefore we can easily deduce that the interest in cell-derived neuronal products is very high worldwide, because these trials are ongoing in three different continents. At least they are in China, USA, in Japan, in Europe, UK, and Sweden, and as well as Australia. Apart from pharmacologic treatments, there is well-established treatment called deep brain stimulation, but is there anything new and any new development to this already proven treatment? So first of all, we know that in DBS, the main targets of stimulation were globus pallidus internus and subthalamic nucleus. And with stimulation of these regions, the dyskinesias and tremors of the patients are very well controlled. But there is potential for more, especially if the target of the stimulation will change. Scientists and physicians are proposing to make a more flexible program, like to target different areas in the brain. Namely, one of these proposed targets is pedunculopontine nucleus. But because there is variability of anatomical definition, suboptimal programming settings might be involved, and the patient numbers were low in the trial that assessed effectiveness and of pedimethalpontine nucleus stimulation. Now there is idea that more clinical trials and more research needs to be done with better better trial settings so that it can be conducted appropriately. With the stimulation of substantia nigra reticularis, the axial symptoms that the patients with PD are experiencing were decreased much more than with other either pharmacologic or the classical VBS. And these axial symptoms are postural instability and gait disturbances, swallowing problems. Basal forebrain stimulation together with subthalamic nucleal stimulation resulted in more positive effects on cognitive deficits that the patients were experiencing. And even thoracic spinal cord was stimulated as a feature of this trial. And a freezing episode that are very debilitating for the patients and they're sometimes scaring for them, they were elevated. So they became less severe. So there is definitely some more research to be done in these areas because these three areas were the most hopeful new targets of DBS. Recently, another not interventional, but surgical approach has been approved by FDA. It is FUS, which has been approved in 2018. It's a focused ultrasound surgery. Even though it's termed to be a surgery, it's not an invasion. It's not an invasive procedure. There are no scalpels involved. There are no lesions. Everything happens with the ultrasound. MRI is guiding the whole process. Patients are just lying in the MRI machine while the physicians are observing their brain. And on the picture of the right upper corner here, we see all of these yellow beams, which are targeting thalamus. And with so many areas, and there is a small electrode on the scalp of the patient. There is no discomfort for the patient since it's not an invasive surgery. There is no risk for any infection. There is no risk for bleeding or any other complications. So this is more comfortable than DBS for some patients. In difference to deep brain stimulation, this procedure is irreversible. So ablation of any tissue that is made by FUS will be irreversible, but it's easier to do. So in some patients, this is a better option. Plus this particular technique is also approved for essential tremor and patients are actually doing the stuff they usually couldn't do because of tremor, like maybe writing or drinking water. And while they are doing this action, the ultrasound will work. Beams will project on their deep brain structures and their tremors are gone. And this is very dramatical improvement, very quick, and patients can observe this. And this is definitely an option for some group of Parkinson's disease patients. And now there is research whether the surgery with ultrasound of globus pallidus internus or thalamotomy or ablation of other areas such as subthalamic nucleus might be more effective than targeting the thalamus. So this is the next step that this focused ultrasound surgery will develop into. These are my references that I used, and this is the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening, and I hope it was interesting. I know that most of the things that I presented today are currently in research and they are the new treatments, but because there is really need for some medication that will target not only motor symptoms, but also cognitive, neuropsychiatric, and autonomic symptoms of this debilitating disease, it's very important to ask the correct questions of what else can be done, what new areas of the disease can be explored. And with a lot of data and a lot of clinical research that's going on, I think that we'll soon have other emerging medications. Thank you. If there are any questions, I would gladly answer.